Honor, Vijay Patel on behalf of Appellant Michelle Bond. I would request to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal. Your Honors, we are here today because the administrative law judge in this case failed to properly reject the opinions of two agency consultative examiners. And the opinions in question in this case are from Dr. Azevedo and Dr. Colvin.
I'm sorry, is it two agency? What are the two?
The consultative examiners in this case, Your Honor. Now, Dr. Azevedo performed the psychological consultative examination in this case. Dr. Azevedo had the opportunity to observe, interact with Ms. Bond. He had the opportunity to perform objective testing, and he had the opportunity to take a thorough history of Ms. Bond. Based on all that, based on his training, his experience, Dr. Azevedo opined that Ms. Bond would be capable of performing simple 1 and 2 step tasks. She would be unable to maintain consistent work pressure and changes in a routine work setting, and would have moderate to marked limitations in her ability to interact with the general public, supervisors, and co-workers. Now, what the
I don't mean to interrupt, but I just want to give you a fair opportunity to respond to the problem I have with this.
Sure.
The history that I think he's got in his record shows that she reported shopping, dancing, building furniture with her parents, making friends, and socializing with parents of her kids. And so, of course, that soundbite is very damaging, frankly, for your case. And I want to ask you to explain why that isn't a pretty serious contradiction that justified giving his opinion less weight.
Certainly. Your Honor, first, the only issue before this case is the weighing of the medical evidence.
Right.
Now, we take the position that Dr. Azevedo was aware of a lot of those indicators because Ms. Bond informed her.
She told him.
Yes, and Dr. Azevedo took that into consideration in giving his concrete functional limitations. It would have been one thing if Dr. Azevedo was not aware of those things, and that would lend some problems to Dr. Azevedo's opinions, but he was fully aware of that, Your Honor.
Right, and so opposing counsel's getting ready to get up and say, if she says what's in her brief, right, that his opinion's contradicted by his own notes. So what is your response to that, please?
Certainly. So we take the position that the case of Ryan v. Commissioner of Social Security actually applies on all fours, Your Honor. And in that case, the administrative law judge similarly rejected an examiner's opinion because they relied heavily on the claimant's objective testimony. Now, the court in that case noted that it was improper for the administrative law judge to rely, to reject the examiner's opinions because that if they relied on the clinical observations with the claimant's testimony. Here, just like the physician in Ryan, Dr. Azevedo found and relied on his clinical observations, such as the examination noted impaired judgment, the examination found rapid speech, also anxious and depressed mood. Those are the same clinical observations that the court noted in Ryan, Your Honor. So, I go back to the position that Dr. Azevedo was aware of those things in formulating his opinion, Your Honor.
Okay.
Going on with Dr. Azevedo's opinions. Now, the problem in this case, Your Honors, is that the ALJ essentially cherry-picked the opinions of Dr. Azevedo, accepted some, and rejected others. And the sole rationale provided by the administrative law judge for rejecting the majority of Dr. Azevedo's opinions was that they somehow primarily relied on the opinion, the statements of Ms. Bond. There's really no concrete evidence of that, Your Honor. Dr. Azevedo was the physician that examined and observed Ms. Bond. He conducted objective testing. And based on all that, he had concrete functional limitations for Ms. Bond. And again, I also rely on Ryan. And more importantly, Your Honors, every physician, and especially physicians who practice psychiatry and psychology, must, to some extent, rely on what's coming out of the patient's mouth. And that's exactly what Dr. Azevedo did. He took into consideration what Ms. Bond was stating. He didn't find Ms. Bond was malingering. He didn't find Ms. Bond was exaggerating. He found that she put forth a great effort in the testing. So looking at all that, Your Honor, I don't see that crediting that crediting the ALJ's reason as legitimate for rejecting an examiner's opinion would essentially put an end run around weighing evidence from psychiatrists and psychologists, because those physicians predominantly rely on what the patient is stating, Your Honor.
We don't have a treating physician in this case, do we?
We do not, Your Honor. So, and the regulations also provide more weight should be given to the opinions of an examining source. In this case, Dr. Acevedo was an examining physician that was contracted by the Social Security Administration to perform an examination. That's exactly what he did. The regulations also note that more weight is typically given to a physician's opinion that has some continuity throughout the record. And the state agency physician, Dr. Zakowski, also found a marked limitation in his responsibility to interact with the general public. So Dr. Acevedo is not alone in this record of finding such a limitation, Your Honor. And the findings of Dr. Acevedo are material to the case at hand, because a vocational expert testified that all of Dr. Acevedo's opinions would render such an individual unemployable in the national economy. Now, turning to, so the ALJ in this case afforded great weight to the non-examining physician, medical expert Dr. Walter in this case. We take the position that, especially when you're dealing with cases where there's a psychological impairment, a physician who has the ability to interact and observe what the particular claimant is doing should be entitled to more weight. And that's precisely why the regulations provide more weight to an examining or treating physician. Also, the opinions of Dr. Walter are convoluted at best. He noted Ms. Bond would be able to perform 1- and 2-, 3-step tasks as long as she was working alone with a non-overbearing supervisor. I don't know what a non-overbearing supervisor is. It could be argued essentially every supervisor is overbearing to some extent. But just looking at that alone, and then we have the opinions of Dr. Colvin, Your Honors. And Dr. Colvin was the physician who physically examined Ms. Spahn. Dr. Colvin essentially limited Ms. Spahn to less than sedentary work, and the ALJ again provided one reason for rejecting those opinions, and that reason being that the examination was benign. Now, Dr. Colvin's report must be read in context. He found those limitations because of a history of seizures, which the ALJ found to be a severe impairment, and safety concerns.
But the seizures, excuse me, but my notes indicate that there's an entry that the seizures were under control.
That is correct, Your Honor.
Okay.
Ms. Bond did inform, in fact, Dr. Acevedo, but Dr. Acevedo's concern, based on his medical expertise and training, was that because of the safety concerns and the history of seizures, that's why such limitations were warranted. Seizures are unpredictable. I do concede that they are currently controlled, but we don't know if a seizure will occur. But the main aspect of that opinion, Your Honor, is that they were not in Dr. Acevedo, Dr. Colvin's opinions were not inconsistent, because he didn't find that she was suffering from a knee problem where there was some objectively verifiable evidence, but he based it on safety concerns of her seizures and a history of seizures, Your Honor. If there are no more questions, I would request to reserve the rest of time for rebuttal.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the Court, my name is Tina Saladino, and I represent Acting Commissioner Carolyn Colvin of the Social Security Administration. It's the Commissioner's position that the ALJ properly gave reduced weight to the examining physician, Omar Colon, because it was inconsistent with the doctor's own benign examination findings, the opinions of two state agency physicians, as well as the treating clinical notes of Dr. Gronland and Dr. Gupta. In addition, the ALJ properly gave reduced weight to examining psychologist Joe Acevedo's opinion because it was based on claimant's subjective complaints, which the ALJ properly found not credible, and a determination that claimant does not challenge. In addition, this opinion was inconsistent with the most recent medical expert opinion, that of Sydney Walter, who had the opportunity to review all of the medical evidence as well as observe Ms. Bond at hearing. In addition, it was inconsistent with the opinions of state agency physicians. If we look at the ALJ's decision, immediately after he talks about Dr. Azevedo's opinion, he also addresses the opinion of Dr. Walter, as well as Dr. Zukowski and Dr. Paxton, if we look at pages 8 through 9. In addition, the ALJ discusses claimant's limited mental health treatment, as well as her normal examination findings.
Well, you know, she does say she is on a lot of medications. I found that curious. The reason I asked about the treating physician is she goes to the examining physician, and then she reports that she's on, clonopin, which is an anti-seizure medication, Tegretol, which is used to control convulsive behavior and treat mood disorder, Advair, that goes on, the list goes on. So somebody has prescribed her some pretty heavy-duty medications.
Correct, but if we look at the overall objective medical evidence and even the claimant's own statements as to her activities, it's obvious that her seizures are not disabling. Many people have epilepsy and they live with that. They work with epilepsy. In this case, she even concedes in the medical notes that once she stops using marijuana, her seizures cease. She tells her doctor,
counsel, I think the point is, I grant you that, that's how I read the record, but there's also a lot of folks who take pretty significant medication, which I think is Chief Judge Thomas's point, and have side effects. And so, what about that medication?
Well,
she has to be on it to control her seizures. It seems to me that any side effects have to be taken into account.
Correct, but there's no indication in the objective medical evidence that she has any side effects that would cause a disabling limitation. If we look at the actual examination findings of Dr. Azevedo, contrary to what, and respectfully to my opponent, she has fair judgment. She scores in the average range in the intelligence testing. She also scores in the average range on motor skills, on adjusting to questioning.
The lifting limitation isn't there because she may have a seizure, she could drop things.
Correct, but the ALJ did not find that consistent with the medical records. And if we even look at, Ms. Bond is claiming disability since 2001. She didn't apply for disability benefits until 2007. If we look at the record in 2004, she's talking about dancing, she's talking about building furniture, she's talking about going bicycling around Chico, she's taking walks, she's ripping up carpet. And
you're not suggesting she should be penalized because she tried to push the room work through the symptoms?
No, what I'm suggesting is that there's inconsistencies with what she's claiming that her disabilities are and what her abilities are and the overall record. Throughout the record, she has normal motor function. She has normal range of motion in her upper extremities. And the only person that is opining that extreme of a lifting limitation is Dr. Colvin.
So what do we know about her bone tumor surgery?
We do know that she had some surgery in terms of her shoulder. However, the medical records of, I believe it's Dr. Gronland, indicate that her shoulder was healed within 12 months of the surgery, and that she did, however, have some limitations resulting from her failure to follow the doctor's orders and in doing, lifting.
She had two right knee surgeries, she had bone tumor surgery, she had right clavicle surgery.
Correct, and yet she's bicycling around town, she's going dancing, she's taking her kids on walks, and she also has negative straight leg tests. She's walking on examination with Dr. Colon while carrying a purse and a bag. The doctor's own examination findings that day do not suggest that her knee surgery has resulted in disability.
The bicycling and all those things are not really inconsistent, as far as I can tell, with Dr. Azevedo's problem about her psychological difficulties in doing work, routine work. They said Dr. Azevedo's discounted because of succeeding doctors, was it Dr. Kelsey's?
Well, we have Dr. Wall. Halter, who is the medical expert that testified at hearing, and he was the most recent opinion, and he found that her mental...
And Dr. Zukowski?
Dr. Zukowski was...
You know what he said about Dr. Zukowski? He didn't believe anybody. He said the opinions of Dr. Zukowski and Pastor are unpersuasive because they're inconsistent. Now, you want to rely on Dr. Zukowski, but he doesn't believe him either.
No, I'm not saying that we should rely on Dr. Kosikowski. I'm saying that in this case, the ALJ takes a balanced approach of looking at all the opinions
that
are coming in.
He didn't say that Dr. Acevedo's report conflicts with any other medical report.
Yes.
But the other medical reports he also doesn't believe.
Yes.
Dr. Acevedo, made it as a professional. Found so incredible. He was a very, it seemed to me, dispassionate person. But he at several points in this report, it says that he examined and listened to her and thought she was credible. And the ALJ also, earlier in his report, lists all of the medically major depressive disorders that she had, generalized anxiety disorder. Post-traumatic stress. These are neuroplastic panic disorder. After that, he said, because these impairments cause more than a minimal functional limitation. This is on page 20 of this report. The claimant has severe impairments.
Right.
That's where we start, that this is a claimant with severe mental impairments.
Right, and diagnosis is not indicative of a diagnosis alone is not indicative of disability, which is why we go to step three. And the ALJ assesses all of these diagnoses in conjunction with the overall objective medical evidence, as well as claimant's own statements and the opinions of various physicians. And the ALJ's responsibility is to look at the overall medical records, all of these opinions, and make a balanced approach in terms of assessing Ms. Bond's residual functional capacity. And I think he did that. Here we have, he opines her. Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Based on, he didn't believe Dr. Colvin for a reason I can't quite understand. He found that it was inconsistent with the benign report, so he gives that one little weight. I don't know how it's inconsistent with the benign report.
In Dr. Colon's report, the October 2000, so he makes two reports on the same day. In one report, he says that claimant cannot lift any weight.
Is that the benign report? It's inconsistent with it.
Well, he's saying...
Well, no, it isn't, because that's not a benign report.
No, what he's saying is that she can't lift any weight, but she notices that she's carrying both a bag and a purse on exam, and that's on page 2. She has full range of motion in her upper extremities, that's page 3. She has full motor strength, that's page 3 of his opinion. She has no gross neurological deficit. That's page 2 through 3. She had normal coordination. Again, that's page 2 through 3.
You're giving a lot of things you might do if you were the ALJ. But what I'm saying is the reason that he discounted Dr. Cohen's report is because it was inconsistent with his own examination of finding benign conditions, not finding unbenign conditions.
Correct. So what he's saying...
He didn't find it was inconsistent with that first chart where he strikes all the tens. He finds it was inconsistent because she was capable of doing all of this.
Yeah, he's saying, the ALJ is saying, end quote, I find it unpersuasive because it is inconsistent with his own examination findings, which were benign. And I would say, what else does he really need to say? The ALJ, in the regulations and in case law, does not need to go through every single individual examination finding. He also, the ALJ, does not need to say, I reject a doctor's opinion, because as long as those findings are discussed in the opinion, and the court can make a logical inference from the opinion as well as the record. And I would say if we look at the opinion, the ALJ does discuss a lot of the objective findings, he states that she's able to walk on exam without an assistive device. And this is a person that comes into court and says that she was prescribed leg braces and a walker. There's no record of her having such a prescription, and there's no record that she even brings such an assistive device into her medical appointments. I would say that the ALJ here took a balanced approach to look at all of the objective medical evidence, and you do have some extreme opinions. You have some doctors, state agency doctors, saying that she has no exertional or postural limitations at all after looking at the record. And then you have Dr. Colvin saying that she has used lifting restrictions. So it's the ALJ's job to take this objective approach and look at the overall record and make a decision based on that. And I would say that here, the ALJ's RFC is supported by substantial evidence. However, if the court does not agree, I think that this is a very clear case that's very similar to Garrison in the sense that there's a lot of conflicting opinions and that there's a lot of conflicting evidence. And similar to Dominguez, we have a person that is not entirely credible in terms of her own statements to the ALJ. She's telling the agency on one hand that she has disabling hand, knee, and back impairments. She's telling her doctors on the other hand that she's going out dancing, that she's going on walks, that she's riding her bicycle. Things that really wouldn't be consistent with the allegations that she's making. And I think that those inconsistencies, if the court doesn't agree with the ALJ, would require this court to remand it back to for further administrative proceedings. However, I think that the ALJ here made a decision based on substantial evidence, and I would like to reserve time for rebuttal. I would like to end there if the court has any additional questions.
Thank you.
Okay.
The biggest problem in this case really is these brief instances of some activities that Ms. Bond is performing. Again, Dr. Acevedo took those things into consideration. It'd be one thing for the ALJ to discredit Ms. Bond based on those activities and those limitations, but it's a separate aspect to reject a physician's opinions based on the claimant's testimony, especially if the examiner took that into consideration, found that she put in a good effort, and found that she wasn't malingering or exaggerating. And that's what Dr. Acevedo did, Your Honors.
But it's tough, isn't it? Because there's an adverse credibility finding here, right?
Correct.
And it's not really appealed, right?
Correct.
And many of these reports, particularly Dr. Acevedo's, you know, by definition, because to your point, he's a psychologist. He's an examining psychologist. So, of course, he's relying heavily on what she tells him. You have an appealed and adverse credibility finding. So what do I do with that?
Respectfully, Your Honor, I don't think Dr. Acevedo heavily relied on him because he did find severe clinical limitations at 565. The speech was rapid and tangential, and the commissioner noted that the judgment was fair and respectfully. Actually, the judgment was variably impaired, Your Honor, in a depressed, anxious mood. The mind cannot be probed into. Naturally, the subjective testimony must be taken into consideration based on the training and experience of Dr. Acevedo. He did take that into consideration and found those concrete limitations.
Okay.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
Thank you both for your arguments today. The case just heard will be submitted for decision.